Hello? Oh my god. I am speaking to you from the other side. I have been kidnapped by my doll, my mannequin head doll thing. I couldn't figure out what music to play because last time I played something and I thought it was all copyright free because it said it was copyright free, but it actually wasn't. So it cut off part of one of the chapters I read last time. So yeah, that kind of sucked, but you guys didn't miss anything like that much in the part that was muted, so it's fine. Should I just put my regular jazz? It'd be really funny. It would not go with it at all. Should I just not? I'll read in silence, actually. Okay, I'll do that. It's kind of hot in here. Okay, so I didn't feel like showing my face again, but I was like, I want to read, and I haven't caught you guys up like last time we stayed on chapter 5, and I have not continued since like last week. So I was like, okay, I have to read, but like I don't want to show my face. So we're doing this. You guys like the button glasses? Yeah, I used them for like my Halloween costume this year. Pretty nice. Okay. All right. We're starting from chapter 5. If you missed the last 4 or 5 chapters, I don't know math. If you missed the last chapters, I think they are still on my channel. I'm not sure. But if not, go to my YouTube channel and it's there. I promise you it is there in case you want to catch up. Okay. So chapter 5 of Coraline by Neil Gaiman. Gaiman. No, I'm so sorry if I said that incorrectly. Gaiman. I'm gonna say Gaiman. Gaiman? I have no idea. Okay, chapter 5. This is the photo. Oh my god, I showed my hand. It's a rat with the key. All right. Excuse me if I mess up on my reading. I'm not very good at reading out loud. Chapter 5. Coraline locked the door of the drawing room with the cold black key. She went back into the kitchen and climbed onto the chair. She tried to put the bunch of keys back on the top of the door frame again. She tried 4 or 5 times before she was forced to accept that she wasn't big enough, and she put them down on the counter next to the door. Her mother still hadn't returned from her shopping expedition. Coraline went to the freezer and took out the spare loaf of frozen bread, ew, in the bottom compartment. She made herself some toast with jam and peanut butter. She drank a glass of water. She waited for her parents to come back. When it began to get dark, Coraline microwaved herself a frozen pizza. Then Coraline watched television. She wondered why grown-ups gave themselves all the good programs with all the shouting and running around in. After a while, she started yawning. Then she undressed, brushed her teeth, and put herself to bed. In the morning, she went into her parents' room, but their bed hadn't been slept in, and they weren't around. She ate canned spaghetti for breakfast. For lunch, she had a block of cooking chocolate and an apple. The apple was yellow and slightly shriveled, but it tasted sweet and good. For tea, she went down to see Mrs. Spink and Forcible. She had 3 digestive biscuits, a glass of limeade, and a cup of weak tea. The limeade was very interesting. It didn't taste anything like limes. It tasted bright green and vaguely chemical. Coraline liked it enormously. She wished they had it at home. How? Oh God. How? Yeah, okay. How are your dear mother and father? Asked Miss Spink. Missing, said Coraline. I haven't seen either of them since yesterday. I'm on my own. I think I've probably become a single child family. Tell your mother that we found a Glasgow Empire Press clippings we are telling her about. She seemed very interested when Miriam mentioned them to her. She vanished under mysterious circumstances, said Coraline, and I believe my father has as well. I'm afraid we'll be out all day tomorrow. All day tomorrow, Caroline, said Miss Forcible. will be staying over with April's niece in Royal Tunbridge Wells. They showed Coraline a photographic album with photographs of Mrs. Spink's niece in it, and then Coraline went home. She opened her money box and walked down to the supermarket. She bought two large bottles of limeade and a chocolate cake and a new bag of apples and went back home and ate them for dinner. She cleaned her teeth and went into her father's office. She woke up his computer and wrote a story. Coraline's story. There was a girl, her name was Apple. She used to dance a lot. She danced and danced until her feet turned into sausages. The end. She printed out the story and turned off the computer. Then she drew a picture of the little girl dancing underneath the words on the paper. She ran herself a bath with too much bubble bath in it, and the bubbles ran over the side and went all over the floor. She dried herself and the floor as best she could and went to bed. Coraline woke up in the night. She went into her parents' bedroom, but the bed was made and empty. The glowing green numbers on the digital clock glowed 3:12 a.m. All alone in the middle of the night, Coraline began to cry. There was no other sound in that empty flat. She climbed into her parents' bed, and after a while, she went to sleep. Coraline was woken by cold paws batting her face. She opened her eyes. Big green eyes stared back at her. It was the cat. "Hello," said Coraline. "How did you get in?" The cat didn't say anything. Coraline got out of bed. She was wearing a long t-shirt and pajama bottoms. "Have you come to tell me something?" The cat yawned, which made its eyes flash green. Do you know where Mom and Dad are?" The cat blinked at her slowly. "Is that a yes?" The cat blinked again. Coraline decided that that was indeed a yes. "Will you take me to them?" The cat stared at her, then it walked out into the hall. She followed it. It walked the length of the corridor and stopped at the very end where a full-length mirror hung. The mirror had been a long time before the inside of a wardrobe door. It had been hanging there on the wall when they moved in, and although Coraline's mother had spoken occasionally of replacing it with something newer, she never had. Coraline turned on the light in the hall. The mirror showed the corridor behind her. That was only to be expected, but reflected in the mirror were her parents. They stood awkwardly in the reflection of the hall. They seemed sad and alone. As Coraline watched, they waved to her, slowly with limp hands. Coraline's father had his arm around her mother. In the mirror, Coraline's mother and father stared at her. Her father opened his mouth and said something, but she couldn't hear nothing at all. Her mother breathed on the inside of the mirror glass, and quickly, before the fog faded, she wrote, "Help us," but backwards, you know, because, like, a mirror. With the tip of her forefinger. The fog on the inside of the mirror faded, and so did her parents, and now the mirror reflected only the corridor and Coraline and the cat. "Where are they?" asked Coraline. "Asked the cat." The cat made no reply, but Coraline could imagine its voice, dry as a dead fly on a windowsill in winter, saying, "Well, where do you think they are?" "They aren't gonna come back, are they?" said Coraline. "Not under their own steam." The cat blinked at her. Coraline took it as a yes. "Right," said Coraline. "Then I suppose there is only one thing left to do." She walked into her father's study. She sat down at his desk. Then she picked up the telephone and she opened the phone book and telephoned the local police station. "Police," said a gruff male voice. "Hello," she said. Oh my god. "My name is Coraline Jones. You're a bit after your bedtime, aren't you, young lady?" said the policeman. "Possibly," said Coraline, who was not going to be diverted, "but I am ringing to report a crime." "What sort of crime would that be?" "Kidnapping. Grown-up napping, really. My parents My parents, where was I? My parents had been stolen away into a world on the other side of the mirror in our hall. And do you know who stole them? Asked the police officer. Coraline could hear the smile in his voice, and she tried extra hard to sound like an adult might sound, to make him take her seriously. I think my other mother has them both in clutches. She may want to keep them and sew their eyes with black buttons, or she may simply have to have them in order to lure me back into reach of her fingers. I'm not sure. Ah, the nefarious clutches of her fiendish fingers is it? He said. You know what I suggest, Miss Jones? No, said Coraline. What? You asked your mother to make you a big old mug of hot chocolate and then give you a great big old hug. There's nothing like hot chocolate and a hug for making the nightmares go away. And if she starts to tell you off for waking her up at this time of night, why you tell her that that's what the policeman said. He had a deep, reassuring voice. Coraline was not reassured. When I see her, said Coraline, I shall tell her that. And she put down the telephone. The cat, who had sat on the floor, grooming his fur through this entire conversation, now stood up and led the way into the hall. Coraline went back into her room and put on her blue dressing gown and her slippers. She looked under the sink for a flashlight and found one, but the batteries had long since run down, and it barely glowed with the faintest straw-colored light. She put it down again and found a box of, in case of emergency, white wax candles and thrust one into a candlestick. She put an apple into each pocket and picked up the ring of keys and took the old black key off the ring. She walked into the drawing room and looked at the door. She had the feeling that the door was looking at her, which she knew was silly, and knew on a deeper level was somehow true. She went back into her bedroom and rummaged in the pocket of her jeans. She found the old stone with the hole in it and put it in her dressing gown pocket. She lit a candle and a match. She lit a candle wick with a match and watched it sputter and light. And then she picked up the black key. It was cold in her hand. She put it into the keyhole in the door, but it didn't turn the key. When I was a little girl, said Coraline to the cat, when we lived in our old house a long, long time ago, my dad took me for a walk on the wasteland between our house and the shops. It wasn't the best place to go for a walk, really. There were all these things that people had thrown away back there. Old cookers and broken dishes and dolls with no arms and no legs and empty cans and empty bottles. Mom and Dad make me promise not to go exploring back there because there were too many sharp things and tetanus and such. But I kept telling them I wanted to explore it. So one day, my dad put me on his big brown boots and his gloves, and put my boots on me and my jeans and sweater, and we went for a walk. We must have walked around for 20 minutes. We went down this hill to the bottom of a gully where steam was. When my dad suddenly said to me, Coraline, run up the hill, now. He said it in a tight sort of way, urgently, so I did. I ran up the hill. Something hurt me on the back of my arm as I ran, but I kept running. As I got to the top of the hill, I heard somebody thundering up the hill behind me. It was my dad, charging like a rhino. When he reached me, he picked me up in his arms and swept over the edge of the hill. And then we stopped, and we puffed, and we panted, and we looked back down at the gully. We looked back down the gully. The air was alive with yellow wasps. We must have stepped on the wasp nest in a rotten branch as we walked. And while running up the hill. My dad stayed and got stung. It gave me time to run away. His glasses had fallen off when he ran. I only had one sting on the back of my arm when he had 39 stings all over him. We counted later in the bath. The black cat began to wash its face and whiskers in a manner that indicated increasing impatience. Coraline reached down and stroked the back of its head and neck. The cat stood up, walked several paces until it was out of her reach. Then it sat down and looked up at her again. "So," said Coraline. Later that afternoon, my dad went back again to the wasteland to get his glasses back. He said if he left it another day, he wouldn't have been able to remember where they had fallen. And soon he got home, wearing his glasses. He said that he wasn't scared when he was standing there. The wasps were stinging him and hurting him, and he was watching me run away. Because he knew he had to give me enough time to run, or the wasps would have come after both of us. Coraline turned the key in the door, and it turned with a loud dunk. The door swung open. There was no brick wall on the other side of the door, only darkness. A cold wind blew through the passageway. Coraline made no move to walk through the door, and he said that... And he said that that wasn't brave of him. Ding just... Okay, let me start over. And he said that wasn't brave of him, doing that. Just standing there and being stung, said Coraline to the cat. It wasn't brave because he wasn't scared, and it was only the only thing he could do. But going back again to get his glasses, when he knew the wasps were there, when he was really scared, that was brave. She took her first step down the dark corridor. She could smell dust and damp and mustiness. The cat padded along beside her. "And why was that?" asked the cat, although it sounded barely interested. "Because," she said, "when you're scared but you still do it anyway, that's brave." The candle cast huge, strange, flickering shadows along the wall. She heard something moving in the darkness beside her, to one side of her, she could not tell. It seemed as if it was walking, it was keeping pace with her, whatever it was. "And that's why you're going back to her world then," said the cat, "because your father once saved you from wasps?" "Don't be silly," said Coraline. "I'm going back for them because they are my parents, and if they noticed I was gone, I'm sure they would do the same for me. You know you're talking again." How fortunate I am," said the cat, "in having traveling companion of such wisdom and intelligence." Its tone remained sarcastic, but its fur was bristling, and its brush of tail struck up in the air. Coraline was going to say something like sorry, or wasn't it a lot shorter walk last time, when the candle went out, and suddenly, as if it had been snuffed by someone's hand, there was a scrabbling and a pattering, and Coraline could feel her heart pounding against her ribs. She put out one hand and felt something wispy, like a spider's web, brush her hands and her face. At the end of the corridor, the electric light went on. Blinding after the darkness, a woman stood, silhouetted by the light, a little ahead of Coraline. "Coraline, darling," she called. "Mom." "Mom." She's just not excited at all. "Mom." And she ran forward, eager and relieved. "Why did you ever run away from me?" said the woman. Coraline was too close to stop, and she felt the other mother's cold arms enfold her. She stood there, rigid and trembling, as the other mother held her tightly. "Where are my parents?" Coraline asked. "We're here," said her other mother, in a voice so close to her real mother's that Coraline could scarcely tell them apart. "We're here. We're ready to love you and play with you and feed you and make your life interesting." Coraline pulled back, and the other mother let her go with reluctance. The other father, who had been sitting on the chair in the hallway, stood up and smiled. "Come into the kitchen," he said. "I'll make us a midnight snack. And you'll want something to drink. Hot chocolate, perhaps?" Girl, that's creepy. Nah, how he know that? How he know that information? Also, there's an ambulance passing by. Coraline walked down the hallway until she reached the mirror at the end. There was nothing reflected in it but a young girl in her dressing gown and slippers, who looked like she had recently been crying, but whose eyes were real eyes and not black buttons, and who was holding tightly to a burnt out candle in a candlestick stick. She looked at the girl in the mirror, and the girl in the mirror looked back at her. "I will be brave," thought Coraline. "No, I am brave." She put down the candlestick on the floor and turned around. The other mother and the other father were looking at her hungrily. "I don't need a snack," she said. "I have an apple. See?" She took the apple from her dressing gown pocket, then bit into it with relish and an enthusiasm that she did not really that she did not really feel. The other father looked disappointed. The other mother smiled, as showing a full set of teeth, and each of the teeth was a tiny bit too long. Ew. The lights in the hallway made her black button eyes glitter and gleam. "You don't frighten me," said Coraline, although they did frighten her very much. "I want my parents back." The world seemed to shimmer a little at the edges. Whatever would I have done with your old parents if they have left you, Coraline? It must be because they became bored of you or tired. Now I will never become bored with you, and I will never abandon you. You will always be safe here with me." The other mother's wet-looking black hair drifted around her head like the tentacles of a creature in the deep ocean. "They weren't bored of me," said Coraline. "You're lying. You stole them." "Silly, silly Coraline. They are fine wherever they are." Coraline simply glared at the other mother. "I'll prove it," said the other mother, and brushed the surface of the mirror with her long white fingers. It clouded over as if a dragon had breathed on it, and then it cleared. In the mirror, it was daytime already. Coraline was looking at the hallway all the way down to her front door. The door opened from outside, and Coraline's mother and father walked in. They carried suitcases. "That was a fine holiday," said Coraline's father. "How nice it is not to have Coraline anymore." Oh my god, that's so evil. She's making this up. Oh my god. That's so evil, so mean. Now we can do all the things we always wanted to do, like go abroad, but we're prevented from doing by having a little daughter. "And," said her father, "I take great comfort in knowing that her other mother will take better care of her n better take better care of her than we could." The mirror fogged and faded and reflected the night once more. "See?" her other mother said. "No," said Coraline. I don't see, and I don't believe it either." She hoped that what she had just seen was not real, but she was not as certain as she sounded. There was a tiny doubt inside her, like a maggot in an apple core. Then she looked up and saw the expression on the other mother's face, a flash of real anger, which crossed her face like summer lightning, and Coraline was sure in her heart that what she had seen in the mirror was no more than an illusion. Coraline sat down on the sofa and ate her apple. "Please," said the other mother, "don't be difficult." She walked into the drawing room and clapped her hands twice. There was a rustling noise, and a black rat appeared. It stared up to her. "Bring me the key," she said. The rat chittered, then it ran through the open door that led back to Coraline's own flat. The rat returned, dragging the key behind it. "Why don't you have your own key on this side?" asked Coraline. "There's only one key, only one door," said the other father. "Hush," said the other mother. "You must not bother our darling Coraline's head with such trivialities. 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 I don't know." She put the key in the keyhole and twisted. The lock was stiff, but it clunked closed. She dropped the key into her apron pocket. Outside, the sky had begun to lighten to a luminous gray. If we aren't going to have a midnight snack, said the other mother, we still need our beauty sleep. I'm going back to bed, Coraline. I would strongly suggest that you do the same. She placed her long white fingers on the shoulders of the other father, and she walked him out of the room. Coraline walked over to the door at the far corner of the drawing room. She tugged on it, but it was tightly locked. The door of her other parents' bedroom was now closed. She was indeed tired, but she did not want to sleep in the bedroom. She did not want to sleep under the same roof as her other mother. The front door was not locked. Coraline walked out into dawn and down the stone stairs. She sat down on the bottom step. It was cold. Something furry pushed itself against her side in one smooth, insinuating motion. Coraline jumped, then breathed a sigh of relief when she saw what it was. "Oh, it's you," she said to the black cat. "See," said the cat. "It wasn't so hard recognizing me, was it? Even without names." "Well, what if I wanted to call you?" The cat wrinkled its nose and managed to look unimpressed. "Calling cats," it confided, "tends to be a rather overrated activity. Might as well call a whirlwind." Excuse me. "What if it was dinner time?" asked Coraline. "Wouldn't you want to be called then?" "Of course," said the cat, "but a simple cry of dinner would do nicely, see? No need for names." "Why does she want me?" Coraline asked the cat. "Why does she want me to stay here with her?" "She wants something to love, I think," said the cat. "Something that isn't her. She might want something to eat as well. It's hard to tell with creatures like that." "Do you have any advice?" asked Coraline. The cat looked as if it were about to say something else sarcastic. Then it flicked its whiskers and said, "Challenge her. There's no guarantee she'll play fair. But her kind of thing loves games and challenges." "What kind of thing is that? Asked Coraline. The cat made no answer, simply stretched luxuriantly and walked away. Then it stopped and turned and said, "I'd go inside if I were you. Get some sleep. You have a long day ahead of you." Then the cat was gone. Still, Coraline realized it had a point. She crept back into the silent house, past the closed bedroom door, inside which the other mother and the other father, what, she wondered, slept, waited, and then it came to her that she would open the bedroom door, and she would find it empty, or more precisely, that it was an empty room, and it would remain empty until the exact moment that she opened the door. Somehow that made it easier. Coraline walked into the green and pink parody of her own room. She closed the door and hauled the toy box in front of it. It would not keep anyone out, but the noise somebody would make to try to dislodge it would wake her up, she hoped. The toys in the toy box were still mostly asleep, and they went back to sleep. Coraline checked under her bed and looking for rats, but there was nothing there. She took off her dressing gown and slippers and climbed into bed and fell asleep with barely enough time to reflect as she did so on what the cat could have meant by a challenge. All right, everyone, that was chapter 5. I'm gonna take a water break because my throat is dying. So give me a second. Go ahead and drink water too. You probably need to also. Oh my god. That was amazing. Okay. The water and the chapter. Okay. My foot is falling asleep. Don't tell anyone. Okay. Chapter 6. Coraline was woken by the mid-morning sun full on her face. For a moment, she felt utterly dislocated. She did not know where she was. She was not entirely sure who she was. It is astonishing just how much of what we can be tied to the beds we wake up in the morning. Okay. And it is astonishing how fragile that can be. Sometimes Coraline would forget who she was while she was daydreaming. Same. Literally me too, bro. She's just like me. While she was daydreaming that she was exploring the Arctic or the Amazon rainforest or darkest Africa, and it was not until someone tapped her on the shoulder and said her name that Coraline would come back from a million miles away with a start and all in a fraction of a second have to remember who she was and what her name was and that she was even there at all. Now there was sun on her face, and she was Coraline Jones. Yes, and the green and pinkness of her room she was in, of the room she was in, and the rustling of a large painted paper but butterfly as it fluttered and beat its own way about the ceiling told me, oh, that's terrifying. There's an image you guys can't see yet. Told her where she had woken up. She climbed. Oh my god. Should I show you guys the photo right now or after? Let me see. Does it have to do with like the rest of the page? No, I'll just show it to you guys. This is the worst one yet so far. That's a little unsettling. I mean, I like it. It looks cool, but like, oh my god. What the heck? What the heck? This is a children's book. As a child, this would have scared me so bad. Like, literally. The movie was like fine because it was fine. It was not scary to me as a child, but this horrifying. I would have had nightmares for days. Okay. She climbed out of the bed. She could not wear her pajamas, dressing gown, and slippers during the day. She decided, even if it meant wearing the other Coraline's clothes. Was there another Coraline? No, she realized there wasn't. There was just her. I just froze. Oh my god. I'm sorry, guys. It's so embarrassing. There were no regular clothes in the cupboard, though. There were more like dressing up clothes, or she thought, the kind of clothes she would love to hang. She would love to have hanging in her own wardrobe at home. There was a Raggedy Witch costume, a patched scarecrow costume, a future warrior costume with a little digital with little with digital l little digital lights in it that glittered and blinked. A slinky evening dress, all covered in feathers and mirrors. This is quite an interesting wardrobe. Feathers and mirrors. Finally, in a drawer, she found a pair of black jeans that seemed to be made of a velvet night and a gray sweater with the color of thick smoke that was faint and tiny stars in the fabric which twinkled. Oh my god, it's the sweater. It's the sweater. The sweet the Coraline sweater, TM. She pulled on the jeans and the sweater. Then she put on a pair of bright orange boots she found at the bottom of the cupboard. She took her last apple out of her pocket, out of the pocket of her dressing gown, and then took from the same pocket the stone with the hole in it. She put the stone into the pocket of her jeans, and it was as if her head had cleared a little, as if she had come out of some sort of fog. She went into the kitchen, but it was deserted. Still, she was unsure that there was someone in the flat. She walked down the hall until she reached her father's study and discovered that it was occupied. "Where's the other mother?" she asked the other father. He was sitting in his study at a desk which ju looked just like her father's, but he was not doing anything at all, not even reading gardening catalogs as her own father did when he was only pretending to be working out, he told her, fixing the doors. "There are some vermin problems." He seemed pleased to have somebody to talk to. "The rats, you mean?" "No, the rats are our friends." Yes! Yes, I love rats. They're so cute. Okay, I agree, they're friends. This is the other kind. Big black fellow with his tail high. "The cat, you mean?" "That's the one," said her other father. He looked less like her true father today. There was something slightly vague about his face, like bread dough, that had begun to rise, smoothing out the bumps and cracks and depressions. "Really, I mustn't talk to you when she's not here," he said. "But don't you worry, she won't be gone often. I shall demonstrate our tender hospitality to you, such that you will not even think about ever going back." He closed his mouth and folded his hands in his lap. "So, what am I to do now?" asked Coraline. The other father pointed to his lips. "Silence." "If you won't even talk to me," said Coraline, "I'm going exploring." "No point," said the other father. "There isn't anywhere but here." This is all that she made, the house, the grounds, and the people in the house. She made it and she waited. Then he looked embarrassed and put one finger to his lips again, as if he had just said too much. Coraline walked out of his study. She went back into the drawing room over the old door and pulled it, rattled and shook it. No, it was locked fast. The other mother had the key. She looked around the room. It was so familiar that was what made it feel so truly strange. Everything was exactly the same as she remembered. There was all her grandmother's strange-smelling furniture. There was the painting of a bowl of fruit, a bunch of grapes, two plums, a peach, and an apple, hanging on the wall. There was the low wooden table with the lion's feet, and the empty fireplace, which seemed to suck heat from the room. But there was something else, something she did not remember seeing before, a ball of glass up on the mantelpiece. She went over to the fireplace, went up on tiptoes, and lifted it down. It was a snow globe with two little people in it. Coraline shook it and set the snow flying, white snow that glittered as it tumbled through the water. Then she put the snow globe back on the mantelpiece and carried on looking for her true parents for a way out. She went out of the flat, past the flashing lights door behind her, where the other Mrs. Spink and Forcible performed their show forever, and she set off into the woods where Coraline came from. Into the woods where Coraline came from. Once you were through a patch of trees and you saw nothing but the meadow and the old tennis court. In this place, the woods went on farther. The trees would becoming cruder and less tree-like the farther you went. Pretty soon, they seemed very approximate, like the idea of trees, a grayish-brown trunk below, a greenish splotch of something that might have been leaves above. Coraline wondered if the other mother wasn't interested in the trees, or if she just hadn't been bothered with this bit properly because nobody was expected to come out this far. She kept walking, and then the mist began. It was not damp, like a normal fog or mist. It was not cold, and it was not warm. It felt to Coraline like she was walking into nothing. "I'm an explorer," thought Coraline to herself, "and I need all the ways of here that I can get. So I shall keep walking." The world she was walking through was a pale nothingness, like a blank sheet of paper or an enormous empty white room. It had no temperature, no smell, no texture, no taste. "It certainly isn't mist," thought Coraline, although she did not know what it was. For a moment she wondered if she might not have gone blind. But no, she could see herself plain as day, but there was no ground beneath her feet, just a misty, milky whiteness. "And what do you think you're doing?" said a shape to her one side of her. It took a few moments for her eyes to focus on it properly. She thought it might be some kind of lion at first, some distance away from her, and then she thought it might be a mouse close beside her. And then she knew what it was. "I'm exploring," Coraline said, told the cat. In fur stood straight out from its body, and its eyes were wide. While its tail was down and between its legs, it did not look like a happy cat. "Bad place," said the cat. "If you want to call it a place, which I don't, what are you doing here?" "I'm exploring." "Nothing to find here," said the cat. "This is just outside, the part of the place she hasn't bothered to create." "She?" "The one who says she's your other mother," said the cat. "What is she?" asked Coraline. The cat did not answer, just padded through the pale mist beside Coraline. A shape began to appear in front of them, something high and towering and dark. "You were wrong," she told the cat. "There is something there." And then it took shape in the mist, a dark house which loomed at them of formless whiteness. But that's, said Coraline. "The house you just left," agreed the cat. "Precisely." "Maybe I just turned around in the mist," said Coraline. The cat curled the high tip of its tail into a question mark and tipped its head to one side. "You might have done," it said. "I certainly would not. Wrong indeed. But how can you walk away from something and still come back to it?" "Easy," said the cat. "Think of somebody walking around the world. You start out walking away from something and end up coming back to it." "Small world," said Coraline. "It's big enough for her," said the cat. Spiders' webs only have to be large enough to catch flies." Coraline shivered. "He said that she's fixing all the gates and the doors," she told the cat, "to keep you out." "She may try," said the cat, unimpressed. "Oh yes, she may try. But..." They were standing under a clump of trees now, beside the house. These trees looked much more likely. There was ways in and ways out of places like this that even she doesn't know about. "Did she make this place then?" asked Coraline. "Made it. Found it. What's the difference?" asked the cat. "Either way, she's had it for a very long time." "Hang on." And it gave a shiver and leap, and before Coraline could blink, the cat was sitting with his paw holding down a big black rat. "It's not like I like rats at the best of times," said the cat conversationally, as if nothing had happened. "But the rats in this place are all her spies. She uses them as her eyes and her hands. And with that, the cat let the rat go. It ran several feet, and then the cat, with one bound, was upon it, batting it hard with one sharp clawed paw, while the other paw, it held the rat down. "I love this bit," said the cat happily. "I love this bit." "Want to see me do that again?" That's literally what it says. "No," said Coraline. "Why do you do it?" "You're torturing it." Said the Coraline. The cat said that. It let the rat go. The rat stumbled, dazed, for a few steps, and then it began to run. With a blow of its paw, the cat knocked the rat into the air and caught it in its mouth. "Stop it," said Coraline. The cat dropped the rat between its two firm paws. "There are those," it said, with a sigh, in tones as smooth as oiled silk, "who have suggested that the tendency of a cat to play with its prey is a merciful one. After all, it permits the occasional funny little running snack to escape from time to time. How often does your dinner get to escape?" And then it picked up the rat again in its mouth and carried it off into the woods behind a tree. Coraline walked back into the house. It was all quiet and empty and deserted. Even her footsteps on the carpeted floor seemed loud. Dust motes hung in a beam of sunlight. At the far end of the hall was the mirror. She could see herself walking toward the mirror, and she looked, looking reflected, a little braver than she actually felt. There was nothing else there in the mirror, just her in the corridor. A hand touched her shoulder, and she looked up. The other mother stared down at Coraline with big black button eyes. "Coraline, my darling," she said, I thought we could play some games together this morning. Now you're back from your walk. Hopscotch? Happy families? Monopoly? You weren't in the mirror," said Coraline. The other mother smiled. "Mirrors," she said, "are never to be trusted. Now what game shall we play?" Coraline shook her head. "I don't want to play with you," she said. "I want to go home and be with my real parents. I want you to let them go, to let us all go." The other mother shook her head, and very slowly, "Sharper than a serpent's tooth," she said, "it's a daughter's ingratitude. Still, the proudest spirit can be broken with love." And her long white fingers ragged and caressed the air. "I have no plans to love you," said Coraline, "no matter what. You can't make me love you." "Let's talk about it," said the other mother. She turned and walked into the lounge. Coraline followed her. The other mother sat down on the big sofa. She picked up a shopping bag from beside the sofa and took out a white rustling paper bag from inside it. She extended the hand with it to Coraline. "Would you like one?" she asked politely, expecting it to be toffee or a butterscotch ball. Coraline looked down. The bag was filled with large shiny black beetles crawling all over each other in their efforts to get out of the bag. "No," said Coraline, "I don't want one." "Suit yourself," said the other mother. She carefully picked out a particularly large and black beetle, pulled off its legs, which dropped neatly into a big glass ashtray on the small table beside the sofa, and popped the beetle into her mouth. She crunched it happily. "Yum," she said. "Yum," she said, and took another. "You're sick," said Coraline. "Sick and evil and weird. Is that any way to talk to your mother?" her other mother asks, with her mouth full of black beetles. Oh my god, they're just like crawling out as she's saying that. "Oh, you aren't my mother," said Coraline. Oh my god, guys, here we go. Oh my god, stuff's about to go down. Her other mother ignored this. "Now, I think you are a little overexcited, Coraline. Perhaps this afternoon we could do a little embroidery together, or some watercolor painting. Then dinner, and then if you had been good, you may play with the rats a little before bed. And I shall read you a story and tuck you in and kiss you goodnight." Her white long fingers fluttered gently like a tired butterfly, and Coraline shivered. "No," said Coraline. The other mother sat on the sofa. Her mouth was set in a line. Her lips were pursed. She popped another black beetle into her mouth and then another, like someone with a bag of chocolate-covered raisins. Her big black button eyes stared into Coraline's hazel eyes. Her shiny black hair twined and twisted about her neck and shoulders, as if it were blowing in some wind that Coraline could not touch or feel. They stared at each other for over a minute. Then the other mother said, "Manners!" She folded the white paper back carefully so no black beetles could escape, and she placed it back in the shopping bag. Then she stood up and up and up. She seemed taller than Coraline remembered. She reached into her apron pocket and pulled out first the black door key. Then she frowned at it and tossed it into her shopping bag. Then a tiny silver colored key. She held it up triumphantly. "There we are," she said. "This is for you, Coraline, for your own good, because I love you, to teach you manners. Manners maketh man, after all." She pulled Coraline back into the hallway and advanced upon the mirror at the end of the hallway. Then she pushed the tiny key into the fabric of the mirror, and she twisted it. It opened like a door, revealing a dark space behind it. "You may come out when you have learned some manners," said the other mother. "And when you're ready to be a loving daughter." She picked Coraline up and pushed her into the dim space behind the mirror. A fragment of beetle was sticking Nah. A fragment of beetle was sticking to her lower lip, and there was no expression at all in her but black button eyes. And then she swung the mirror door closed and left Coraline in darkness. Not the leg of the beetle on her lip, bro. It's like she has, like, ma'am, you have a leg between your teeth. Like, sorry to bother you. You got a beetle leg stuck between your teeth. That's nasty. Okay. All right, this is the photo on the next, is this chapter? No. Oh my god, it is. Oh wait, actually, no, we're not there yet. Why did I skip a page? That's weird. Okay, chapter 7, everyone. Let me actually drink a little bit of water. Okay. Chapter 7. Somewhere inside her, Coraline could feel a huge sob swelling up, and then she stopped it. Before it came out, she took a deep breath and let it go. She put out her hands to touch the space in which she was imprisoned. It was the size of a broom closet, tall enough to stand in or to sit in, not wide or deep enough to lie down in. One wall was glass, and it felt cold to the touch. She went around the tiny room a second time, running her hands over every surface that she could reach, feeling for doorknobs or switches or concealed catches for catches, some kind of way out, and found nothing. A spider scuttled over the back of her hand, and she choked back a shriek. But apart from the spider, she was alone in the closet, in the pitch dark. Then her hand touched something that felt all for, like the world all for that felt for all the world like somebody's cheek and lips, small and cold. A voice whispered in her ear, "Hush and shush, say nothing, for the Beldam might be listening." Coraline said nothing. "It's the ghost children. Everybody, look at the ghost children." Very nice. They look. Actually, you know what? I thought they looked creepier in the movie. They just kind of look. They actually don't have button eyes in this book. Okay. She felt a cold hand touch her face, fingers running over it like the gentle beat of a moth's wings. Another voice, hesitant and so faint, Coraline wondered if she was imagining it, said, Art thou alive?" "Yes," whispered Coraline. "Poor child," said the first voice. "Who are you?" whispered Coraline. "Names, names, names," said another voice, all far away and lost. "The names are the first things to go after the breath has gone and the beating of the heart. We keep our memories longer than our names. I still keep pictures in my mind of my governess on some May morning, carrying my hoop and stick and the morning sun behind her, and all the tulips bobbing in the breeze. But I have forgotten the name of my governess, and of the tulips too. I don't think tul Ooh, knocked something over. I don't think tulips have names," said Coraline. "They're just tulips." "Perhaps," said the voice sadly, "but I have always thought that these tulips must have had names. They were red and orange and red. Wait, they were red and orange and red and orange and yellow, like the embers in the nursery fire of a winter's evening. I remember them." The voice sounded so sad that Coraline put a hand to the place where the voice was coming from, and she found a cold hand and sque she que she squeezed she squeezed it tightly. Her eyes were beginning to get used to the darkness. Now Coraline saw, or imagined she saw, three shapes, each as faint and as pale as the moon in the daytime sky. They were shapes of children about her own size. The cold hand squeezed her hand back. "Thank you," said the voice. "Are you a girl?" asked Coraline, "or a boy?" There was a pause. "When I was small, I wore skirts and my hair was long and curled," it said doubtfully. But now that you ask, it does seem to me that one day they took my skirts and gave me breeches and cut my hair. "'Tain't something we give a mind to," said the first of the voices. "A boy, perhaps, then," continued the one. "A boy, perhaps, then," continued the one whose hand she was holding. "I believe I was once a boy," and it glowed a little more brightly in the darkness of the room behind the mirror. "What happened to y'all?" asked Coraline. "How did you come here?" "She left us here," said one of the voices. "She stole our hearts and stole our souls, and she took our lives away. And she left us here, and she forgot about us in the dark." "You poor thing," said Coraline. "How long have you been here?" "So very a long time. So very long time. Long a time. What? So very long a time," said a voice. "Aye, time beyond reckoning," said another. These children are British or something. Hold on. "So very long a time," said a voice. That's so bad. I'm so sorry, British people. "Aye, time beyond reckoning," said another voice. Alright, I'll do it normally. "I walked through the scullery door," said the voice of the one that thought it might be a boy. "And I found myself back in the parlor. But she wasn't waiting for me. She told me she was my other mama, but I never saw my true mama again." "Flee," said the other first of the voices, another girl Coraline fancied. Oh, wait, what? Of the voices, another girl Coraline fancied. "Flee while there's still air in your lungs and blood in your veins and warmth in your heart. Flee while you still have your mind and soul." "I'm not running away," said Coraline. "She has my parents. I came to get them back. But she'll keep you here while the days turn to dust and the leaves fall and the years pass one after the next, like the tick-tick-tocking of a clock." Tick-tick-ticking of a clock. "No," said Coraline, "she won't." There was a silence then in the room behind the mirror. Peradventure, said a voice in the darkness. "If you could win your mama and your papa back from the beldam, you could also win free our souls." "Has she taken them?" asked Coraline, shocked. "Aye, and hidden them. That is why we could not leave here when we died. She kept us and she fed on us until now we've nothing left of ourselves. Only snakeskins and spider husks find our secret hearts, young mistress." "And what will happen to you if I do?" asked Coraline. The voices said nothing. "And what is she going to do with me?" she asked. The pale figures pulsed faintly. She could imagine that they were nothing more than after images, like the glow left by a bright light in your eyes after the lights go out. "It doth not hurt," whispered one faint voice. "She will take your life and all that, and all you are and all you cared for, and she will leave you with nothing but mist and fog. She'll take your joy, and one day you'll wake up, your heart and your soul will have gone. A husk you'll be, a wisp you'll be, a thing no more than a dream on waking, or a memory of something forgotten." "Hollow," whispered the third voice. "Hollow, hollow, 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 hollow." "You must flee," sighed a voice faintly. "I don't think so," said Coraline. "I tried running away, and it didn't work. She took my parents. Can you tell me how to get out of this room?" "If we knew, then we would tell you, poor thing," said Coraline to herself. She sat down. She took off her sweater and rolled it up and put it behind her head as a pillow. "She won't keep me in the dark forever," said Coraline. "She brought me here to play games." "Games and challenges," the cat said. "I'm not much of a challenge here in the dark." She tried to get comfortable, twisting and bending herself to fit the cramped space behind the mirror. Her stomach rumbled. She ate her last apple, taking the tiniest bites, making it last as long as she could. When she had finished, she was still hungry. Then an idea struck her head. and she whispered, "When she comes to let me out, why don't you three come with me?" "We wish we could do that," they sighed to her in their barely there voices. "But she has our hearts in her keeping, and now we belong to the dark and to empty spaces. The light would shrivel us and burn." "Oh," said Coraline. She closed her eyes, which made the darkness darker, and she rested her head on the rolled-up sweater, and she went to sleep. As she fell asleep, she thought she felt a ghost kiss her cheek tenderly, and a small voice whisper into her ear, a voice so faint it was barely there at all, a gentle, wispy nothing of a voice, so hushed that Coraline could almost believe she was imagining it. "Look through the stone," it said to her, and then she slept.
Oh, chapter 8 already? What do you mean, chapter 8 already? Oh my god, that was actually quick. Should I continue, or shall I do it later? Let's see, we read two chapters. Two chapters. How long is chapter 8? Quite long. I think I will leave it for later, because she fell asleep. And I think it is time for everyone, including me, to go to sleep. So, thank you everyone for listening. I will be uploading this to YouTube in case anyone missed anything, any parts, or just wants to watch it again. Thank you guys. I'm gonna go now. Goodbye. Look at the book. The book is right there. Oh my god. Oh my god, the book. Goodbye.